Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the President of the American Planning Association, Carol Ray, FAICP.
Good afternoon. I hope you've enjoyed this year's National Planning Conference. Good, good. As planners, we are always balancing today's needs against what tomorrow might bring for our communities. Resilience is a great concern, especially if you live in a coastal community. Several of APA's National Planning Award recipients have focused on resiliency planning efforts. In fact, yesterday we learned about the Best Practice Award recipient that is focusing on enhancing New Orleans resiliency. On a national level, the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development awarded $1 billion in funding in January for its National Disasters Resilience Competition. This funding will be used to address resilient housing and infrastructure projects. And last month, APA announced it is working with the Association of State Floodplain Managers on a $700,000 grant from NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. The grant will focus on regional scale efforts to research, identify, and pilot test techniques for reducing climate hazards facing coastal communities through capital improvement planning. And all of our ongoing resiliency work ties into what our final speaker will address today. John Englander is an oceanographer and sea level rise expert. His marine science background, coupled with his education in geology and economics, provide him the background to look ahead at the financial and societal impacts related to sea level rise. His best-selling book, High Tide on Main Street, Rising Sea Level and the Coming Coastal Crisis, explores intelligent adaptation that all businesses and coastal communities must consider today. The former CEO of the Cousteau Society and the International Seakeepers Society, Englander is the founder of the Rising Seas Group. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to introduce our closing keynote speaker, Mr. John Englander.
Thank you. What a pleasure to be here. I have never participated in the APA before, but I would like to think that this is the beginning and not the end, although it's the end of this conference. I'm probably not supposed to tell you this, but I understood that the short list for who might do this job was Elon Musk from Tesla Motors and Neil deGrasse Tyson, and I would have preferred that it was one of them, because I'd like to hear them talk in person. But the more I thought about, after my ego got a little back down to earth, that I was in that company, I thought about what does it mean that the American Planning Association thought of those possibilities as a way to wrap up, you know, intense conference with lots of information and get people going out back to tackle their jobs with fresh vigor and thoughts. And I was really inspired because it meant that, you know, we have different issues about sustainability, how we're going to transport ourselves, how we're going to power our houses that Elon Musk has pioneered, and he's certainly been a brilliant entrepreneur. Neil deGrasse Tyson is a great communicator with his own TV show and an astrophysicist who's able to talk about everything from climate change to a wide variety of scientific topics. But the interest and concern about sea level for a group that talks about planning was really exciting, that you are putting that on the horizon. What I'd like to do with this hour-long segment, I'm going to allow time for questions and answers at the end, but is to provoke you with some thoughts that probably stretch the things you've thought of as resiliency up until now. In doing a little research about planning professional planners, I found that there was a seminal paper back in the 70s, and a few of you started back then, so maybe you'll remember this. It was Horace Riddle and Melvin Weber, who wrote a paper talking about a planning dilemma that they called the wicked problem. Does anybody remember that? I'd just be curious. Well, a few dozen hands, okay. And what they defined as the wicked problem of planning, and they were from UC Berkeley, they were professional urban planners and whatever the other category aspect of planning was, but they both came from your culture and your profession. And they wrote about the wicked problem, and they defined it in a good published peer-reviewed paper, as a problem where the solution is not easily defined. It's not like a normal problem like how to build the new bridge, or how to increase the size of a city, or do a major structure. And a wicked problem is not only hard to define because there doesn't seem to be an end point, but depending on what solutions you take to the problem, changes the end point. Kind of a fascinating concept. And so I found that interesting, and I read the paper yesterday, and I'd recommend it. It's still current, even 40 years later. It's a provocative idea, but what it said to me is that sea level rise and planning for it is a wicked problem. And wicked has a connotation of being terrible, of course, witch-like. But those of you who may have grown up or gone to school in the Boston area know that wicked in Boston means something entirely different. Something can be wicked good in Boston, right? So I want to think of this as an opportunity for some wicked good planning as well as we think about a wicked problem. Sea level rise is a kind of flooding, and we tend to think of it along with the other kinds of flooding, like heavy rainfall and storms and extreme tides, which is sometimes called nuisance flooding now, every 28 days in coastal cities. And sometimes it's mixed in with erosion, beach erosion, which is quite different. And flooding may be flooding if your problem is how to get rid of the water and how to return things to normal. And so it makes perfect sense that the sudden big events are the things that we think of as flooding events. Sea level rise is different, however. And I want to explain to you why we tend to have trouble conceptualizing it and communicating it. That's the first thing. And the second thing I want to do is explain to you why we really can't tell you how bad it's going to be this century, which is unfortunate, but just reality. And the third thing I want to do this afternoon is to suggest to you why this audience, those of you sitting here, are the ideal place to take this in and say, how can we professionalize this? How can we add this on as an entirely different layer beyond what we think of as resiliency and sustainability and recovery from short-term flooding? Because it is different. And then when I've done those three things, I'm going to allow time for questions and answers to make sure that if there's something I say that seems contradictory about sea level rise, something you've heard or believe, let's get that out of the way. You don't have to take notes as I'm going along, by the way. I'm going to throw out some facts. I'm also going to tell you a simple email address. You can do it now, or I'll give it to you at the end as well. Just take out your cell phone. It's really short. And I will send you a set of slides with all the numbers in it and some of the graphics that I use. And many people like to use that, and it's a freebie. And it's just APA, for American Planning Association, at johnenglender.net. Just send me an email with slides in the subject, anything else you want, and you will get a response with a slide deck rather than giving handouts. Sea level rise, or sea level, has been fairly level for 5,000 years. That's pretty much our human civilization. The last century, it's risen as a global average about 8 or 10 inches. It's a problem. It's made the tides worse and the effects of storms worse, and it's going to get worse yet. But culturally, we don't really believe sea level can change much. You have to go back in geologic history. The last time sea level was higher was 120,000 years ago. Anybody remember that? Okay. Back then, it got 25 feet higher than now. 25 feet higher than now. Sea level goes up and down with the ice ages hundreds of feet. Unless you study geology or a related field, you would not know that. And because for 5,000 years it hasn't changed much, as I'm going to show you, we've been fooled. And we tend to lump it in with those other short-term, modest flooding events. But it's a different problem. It's a different wicked problem. So we need to think bigger. And I attended a really good discussion this morning at 8 o'clock. It was the Dutch dialogues about what Norfolk and some of New Orleans are doing about flooding. And fascinating. But, you know, this problem is way beyond New Orleans and Norfolk. This is every coastal community in the world. from Boston to Cape Cod, down to Mystic Seaport, now to Long Island, and the Jersey coast and the Chesapeake. And I was in Annapolis last week at the U.S. Naval Academy. They've got a huge problem of flooding. Sea level rising, exacerbating storm surge impact, and exacerbating the extreme tides is a new problem that not only affects every coastal community in the world, but far inland through the marsh areas. This isn't just on the shoreline. In Florida, the first area to go underwater is going to be out by the Everglades, miles inland, because it's the lowest. It's the flattest. And then far up tidal rivers. So where we think of storm surge and being resilient like a Sandy event or in New York and New Jersey, or a Katrina event in New Orleans, sea level rise is different. It's that just ticking along, getting higher and higher, that's making the extreme tides worse and the storm events when they come. But sea level rise will get up through all those marshland areas and extend them, as well as far inland to Hartford, Connecticut, and Sacramento, California, Washington, D.C., London, England, places that aren't on the ocean. It's a different kind of flooding. And I know this gets pretty sobering and can be depressing, but I assure you that not only am I going to try and show you that there's a glass half full as well as a glass half empty here, but I want to give you some attitudinal approaches that I found over the last 8 years of doing this that help to look at this problem, which can be scary, can be a wicked problem, as something that can be a challenge and an opportunity. And a little bit that's perhaps a purposeful attitude adjustment on my part so that I don't give up. But actually, I think you'll see that there's a lot of reality to it. So first, let me give you a quick tour of where the ice is melting. You know, we tend to not think of the Earth globally until we look at pictures like this, but you've seen more and more pictures probably of what's happening in the Arctic. The sea ice around the North Pole, and some people get concerned about the polar bears and their habitat, and that's certainly worthy of some concern. You may have seen icebergs up close. Some of the cruise ships go in places where you can see icebergs up in Alaska. You may have been fortunate to see a calving event, and perhaps not so fortunate because they can swamp boats. One of the organizers here told me she just saw this recently. There's a beauty to the ice disappearing, of course, that's hard to miss. But as you look at it and see the darkening and the kind of the skeletal look of some of these icebergs, I think it also puts a bit of sad thought that these structures are disappearing. That would be the South Pole. Penguins are in the South Pole, polar bears in the North. And as I've been to the polar regions, I guess, 5 times now, diving under the polar ice cap back in the mid-80s, when there was 10 feet of ice to drill through, that's kind of gone. But the science I want to leave you with is this surprising fact that I find that even educated audiences that should know better are confused by. The melting of the ice at the North Pole does not add to sea level rise. Because like an ice cube in a glass, the ice floats above the liquid, just like a big iceberg. And as that ice melts, it will not change the level of liquid. So that's kind of just the beginning of a little, if you will, short science recap that's really important to understand. But what is important about the melting polar ice cap, the ice around the North Pole, is 2 things to me. As it goes from bright white, which reflects heat, to dark ocean, almost black, it'd be like painting a roof that was white and turning it into a black roof. You'd know your heating bill would change, or air conditioning, right? Because black absorbs a lot more heat. And that's speeding up the warming of the planet as the ice disappears from the North Pole. But when people say to me, well, this has happened before, I'm sure climate change is a natural thing, and you know, it's of course it's happened. That ice has been frozen for 3 million years. The North Pole has been frozen for about 3 million years. So the fact that it's going to be ice-free for a few weeks, starting in late September, sometime in the next 5 or 10 years. We just don't know which year it'll actually happen. And then it'll expand a little bit during the winter time, but year by year will be longer periods of ice-free Arctic. That is an incredible statement that we are entering a new era. We'll come back to that and what's causing sea level in just a moment, but I want to talk to you about the problem of flooding to kind of distinguish those different problems I mentioned earlier. So from the Embarcadero, where most of you have probably been at some time in your lives, famous 7.5 miles of waterfront that partly defines San Francisco, they're getting water coming over the seawall. Now, that seawall elevation was established 140 years ago. This didn't used to happen, and that's not an ocean wave, as you know. That's far enough inside San Francisco Bay that that's just bay chop. The reason that it's coming over the seawall is the ocean is 8 inches higher. And actually, it's getting higher because of some changes from El Nino and some other things out that are happening this year. But the fact is that every month, they have water coming over the seawall. 30 years ago, that didn't happen. It happened maybe once or twice a year. Communities from Annapolis. I was there last week at the Naval Academy. This is, you have to kind of look at this twice. It looks like water in front of you. That's a parking lot. There's boats off to the right that are on the right side of the seawall. But Annapolis keeps records. 50 years ago, they had about 4 days a year of flooding in the downtown where they couldn't pass the downtown area of Annapolis, a 330-year-old city in America, a very important city in our history. Now they've kept records. Their records show that 50 years later, they get 40 days a year on average. So in 50 years, for many of us, in effect, a lifetime or a good part of our working lives, their flooding has been measured by the city government, and it's gone from 4 days to 40 days. That's a powerful statement. Because what I want to suggest to you out of this information I'm starting to share with you is we need to think bigger. We need to think farther so that the shorter-term planning is better. Rising sea level is characterized in lots of ways. This was the cover of National Geographic 3 years ago. They showed how high sea level would be against the Statue of Liberty or when all the ice melts. The truth is that even, and my first sentence of my book is pretty much the same thing, but that's a distraction. It kind of sets a framework of what could happen thousands of years from now. We really need to start thinking about what can happen this century, and I'll give you some different time frames. Again, we tend to think of it as a sandy-like event, but the water recedes in a day or two and you can rebuild. You can be resilient to that, recover. In Fort Lauderdale, we had an example a month after Sandy, a no-name storm tore out 4 blocks of the oceanfront hotel strip. Neighborhoods all over the world have storm drains that were put in 50 years ago in most cases or so to take excess rainfall and take it to some nearby waterway. That storm drain backs up every 28 days with the full moon high tide and brings salt water onto the street. It wasn't that way when they planned that community. Something's changing. It's almost like that boiling the frog metaphor, you know, that if it happens slowly enough, we don't see the big picture. So what I want to leave you with today, and I'm not nearly done yet, but is to say that we need to plan at different levels. We need to plan for the short, the medium, and the long term. But counterintuitively, where most people say, well, I don't have the budget or the bandwidth or my boss doesn't want me to plan 30 years into the future or the end of the century, which is perfectly understandable. But what I have found in doing this for 4 years now of helping communities and national security and all sorts of people begin to look at rising sea level as a new phenomenon, I came to the principle that Stephen Covey, who wrote The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People, many of you probably read that book. It was a great book. And principle number 2 is start with the end in mind, that you can decide the next couple of steps if you know where you want to get to. And I think there's a lot of wisdom in that. And what we're doing with flooding at the moment, and we heard it this morning in that 8 a.m. presentation, is we tend to do the opposite, that many people don't want to look that far ahead. So what's going to happen is we're going to keep redoing things and we're going to keep writing off investments in solutions because we're not thinking big enough. Now, sea level, again, is always been assumed to be the baseline. It wasn't going to change in centuries, so just it's a given line. And on top of sea level is a high tide line. and then when a storm hits, it raises the water height. And if a storm hits at a high tide, it's even higher. And the higher the water column, the farther inland it goes. But again, we assume that sea level was the baseline. When in fact, as sea level rises for each foot, it's going to move the average global shoreline, inland 300 feet, the length of a football field. Now that's hard to believe when you look at the typical beach, but that's not where the incursion is happening. It's happening in those marshlands and up the tidal rivers and in really flat places like Vietnam and Bangladesh and most of South Florida down at the tip. So different places have different problems with sea level rise, and we have to look at them specifically. You've probably seen different curves for sea level. And if we look at the historic, it was pretty flat. It's been rising in the middle there for 8 or 10 inches for the last century, but the current projections are for much higher. But there's a huge range. And when I gave a lecture at the US Naval Academy a week ago today, I pointed out that we're doing something pretty silly. We're taking the range, and typically most people are saying, if we don't know how high sea level will be, let's take the average of the projections. I said, do you do that with hurricanes? Do you plan on a 1 to a 5 hurricane, so we'll design for 2.5? Or an earthquake? No, we plan for the worst cases. So that's one error we're making intuitively with sea level rise projections. The second is, the highest line shown there is not the highest line. There is a higher line. And if you saw the Wall Street Journal or New York Times last week, you may have seen the cover story that said news out of Antarctica bode ill for sea level rise and flooding. And some recent research confirming prior research, but much more definitively, said that you should add another 3 feet to those 3 feet projections for sea level rise. So it gets up to about 6 feet, which is what this shows. But that's not going to be the end of the rise of increases. Now, when you start thinking about 5 or 10 feet of sea level rise in coastal areas, you realize we have a heck of a wicked problem. And we are not looking at it. We are looking at the current flooding, nuisance flooding, storms, and so on. So how do we bridge? How do we go from what's happening now in challenging cities from Miami to Annapolis to San Francisco to Boston, coastal cities all over the world? How do we bridge from this planning challenge, which it certainly is that, and prepare for a bold new future that most people can't even imagine? They're denying it, they're ignorant, they're playing politics, whatever. But you people are right in the midst of how to plan for the future. And so what I hope I wind up doing in the half hour I've still got, and again, we'll take questions, but is to get you to think of this, if you will, glass half empty full metaphor that, you know, we can think of this as a problem, but we can also see where is there an opportunity to do better planning. A lot of people are under the impression that the governmental climate talks, the last one was in Paris in December, you may have heard of it, COP21 they called it, it's the conference of the parties. And 196 nations agreed to try to limit global warming to 2 degrees Celsius, 3.6 Fahrenheit, over pre-industrial. Now let me break that down. Many of you know what that means, but I'll break that down for you. We've already had 0.85 Celsius, about 1.6 degrees, call it a degree and a half, of warming in the last century. That's why the ice is melting. Ice melts at 32 degrees. It doesn't care whether you're Republican or Democrat. It's gonna melt, right? It's not an opinion. It's good to laugh once in a while on this stuff too, by the way. So get it out. It's not a funny subject, but I'd like to help you keep a sense of humor, because like a good doctor or a good engineer or any other, or parent, we need to find ways to look at things and put them into context that we can deal with them. And that's so important if we're going to tackle the problem. So the ice is going to melt because we've already had a degree and a half warming. The nations, 196 nations agreed we should try to limit the future warming to an equal amount, basically. It's questionable whether we can do that, even if we do all the right things with renewable energy and every other incentive possible for sustainability. So here's the dark truth, is even if we succeed with the Paris Agreement, which I hope we do. I think they're going to sign it on Earth Day this year, actually. I hope they do, and I really mean that. And we should do lots of things aimed at sustainability. But even if we give that goal a check mark, sea level is still going to rise tremendously. Because with the extra heat we're allowing to be put in the system, based upon our energy production and population going from 7 billion to 10 billion, which is well cranked into that equation, we are going to have a lot more ice melting. And it's totally erroneous to think that technology is going to solve that. Let me break down technology for a moment for you. Technology of cell phones, electrons, we can do almost anything. We've proven that. Technology of making energy without carbon going into the air, I think we can do that. I really do think in the next 20, 30 years we'll have that wired. Not only current solar and perhaps new kinds of nuclear, wind energy, ocean energy, hydrothermal, we will make our energy without putting more carbon dioxide in the air. I'm confident we will figure that technology out by mid-century. There'll be technology of new materials and new designs and buildings that perhaps can elevate themselves, like a jack-up rig or something, that perhaps could adjust in places where they need to be at the shoreline. I think we'll have that technology. But let's disabuse ourselves. There will be no technology to stop a glacier from calving off into an iceberg, any more than there's a technology to stop a super tornado from progressing through buildings of any strength, or a tsunami from devastating a nuclear power plant, which is built to high standard. We have to separate that there are different kinds of technology. And because ice melting at 32 degrees is not a technical question. It's physics. So I end my book, I end every talk I give, and by the way, every talk I give is very different. If you have opportunities for me, I can assure you it won't be this one, because I've never given this talk before. I think you have to speak to people from where they come, whether it be geographically or their professions, for this to have meaning and impact, which is what I want. And we need to do two things in all earnestness. One is to slow the warming. And there are lots of ways to do that. That's not my field. There's hundreds of thousands of people working on better ways to reduce greenhouse gas emissions and perhaps get some carbon out of the air and do different things. That's great. But even if we succeed 100%, as I said a minute ago, we're going to have sea level rising 1 foot, 2 foot, 3 foot. If we do the first part right, we'll slow the rate of rise. And that would be great. But here's the dark truth. Even if the world went 100% solar now, never burned another piece of coal, another barrel of oil, sea level is still going to rise. It's in the pipeline. The ice is going to melt because we've warmed the ocean. So we need to wake up. And those of you who are in a role to do planning, you may not be able to solve that, but I'm going to give you some suggestions how you can change the dialogue. Not only professionally, but for whoever your clients are, your family, your business associates, because we need to wake up to a new reality. So I'm going to come to that in just a minute. First, I want to make sure we understand the uncertainty of why this is unstoppable. Well, again, I said a few minutes ago that we've had 8 or 10 inches of sea level rise this century. Now it goes up and down. That's since 1850. The line bumps up along and is actually getting a little bit steeper. If you look at that same 8 inches across 13 cities, shown here as vertical bars, the 8 inches is a red wavy line toward the bottom. I'm not sure if you can see that, but regardless, that 8-inch global average turns into 46 inches in New Orleans on the left, 30 inches in Norfolk, which we heard about this morning as the second city on the third column. New York's in the middle with 14, and Los Angeles is off to the right at 4. So how could global sea level rise of 8 to 10 inch average be 46 inches, 14, or 4 during the same time period? Well, it's because the land goes down, subsides, or uplifts. So it means that your approach to planning in different parts of the world needs to be done appropriate to that location. And then there's also geographic forms like the Chesapeake and even San Francisco Bay and the Baltic that funnel water and amplify the effect. And a little bit of that happened during Sandy because of the direction the storm came from, it piled up a little bit in New York Harbor because of Long Island and New Jersey catching it since it came from the southeast. By the way, another quick, maybe funny anecdote. So I worked 4 years on getting my book written and published, and it came out October 22nd, 2012. And I kind of took the afternoon off after the struggle of writing and doing my first book. And that afternoon, there was a tropical disturbance south of Jamaica. I didn't really pay any attention, but I live in Florida, and we do pay attention to those things. A few days later, it was given the name Sandy, and it was heading up the coast. Didn't hit us too bad in Florida, but of course, we know what happened in New Jersey and New York. My wife and I are both originally from New York and have family there and paid close attention to it. And when the storm hit October 29th, 2012, we all watched it on the news, what it was doing. Linda said to me, John, you know, you wrote about this in your book. Now, I'd been through so many edits, I didn't remember what was in the final version after all the edits and shrinking the book down to a manageable size. But there it was on page 121. I described a superstorm hitting Atlantic City in New York, literally. Didn't name it Sandy, of course. I couldn't have possibly done that. But I was on TV the next day. Mr. Englander, how did you plan? I said, I was on British television the next morning. How did you plan this and write your book? You know, I said, of course, that was lucky for terribly, terribly unlucky event. But it was a very fortunate timing for me. So you know that planning is like that. Sometimes we can do great things because of great planning. Sometimes perhaps you get lucky. You'd like to do both, I guess. What does it mean? I'm sorry, I've got a few more slides here before I talk to you about what it means for you. Just to visualize what sea level rise can mean, you all know what Florida looks like today. If I take you back 20,000 years to the last ice age, Florida was twice the size because sea level was down 390 feet. Now, 20,000 years ago sounds like a long time, but of course, it's really not that long. I mean, biblical times get us back to maybe 5,000 years or the Jewish and Chinese calendars. So while we think that a century is a long time, the truth is our history goes back thousands of years. 20,000 years ago, that's what Florida looked like. 120,000 years ago, it was kind of the opposite when sea level was 25 feet higher, as I mentioned earlier, and about half the states remaining. That's geologic history. This is an opinion. It's not a matter of interpretation. It's where we find the shorelines in geology. Sea level has risen about 390 feet, shown here since the last ice age over that 20,000 year period. It got to the present level about 6,000 years ago, and it didn't rise smoothly. There were some bumps along the way, right in the middle. And many of us think we're entering another bump because of the rate of warming. Now, just to put in context why sea level would raise the ocean as the planet warms, it's because of the ice ages. And I don't know if you remember that part of your geology classes, but you remember part two of the four-part series. This was Ice Age Part Two. If you have kids or grandkids, and behind Manny, Diego, Sid, and Scat, my daughter was six then. I watched this about 20 or 30 times. And I do it both to get a laugh, but more important, to help you visualize that we had 2 miles of ice behind them. And that 2 miles of ice, roughly 10,000 feet of ice, as it melted, it raised the ocean 390 feet. That's about all you need to know, the proof of what's happened naturally. And now I'll show you why we're in a different era. Because sea level, it turns out, this is charting 400,000 years of sea level change from what we know from the rock record. I used to go down and find ancient shorelines 200 or 300 feet underwater. And this shows you a long pattern of 400,000 years. And if we lay on top, whoops, we'll come back to that and show you what temperature and carbon dioxide do against that. This slide shows you a glacier about to enter the Arctic Ocean. And of course, this is where sea level is changing as ice goes from land, like putting another ice cube in a glass, or the meltwater that's happening on that island, Greenland, and flowing into the ocean. That's what raises sea level primarily, ice on land that goes into the ocean. The third thing, besides the ice on land or glaciers breaking off into icebergs, is that the oceans expand with temperature. You know, most substances have a very slight dimensional change with temperature. Parts don't fit in the wintertime or key won't go into lock sometimes. And that's happening in the oceans. The oceans have been warmed 1.5 degrees, as I said earlier, and they are about 4 inches taller just because they are warmer. The other 4 inches has come from those glaciers and icebergs melting on land. hope that makes sense. But what's about to happen, or what has actually just started to happen, is on a different scale. What is happening out of Antarctica that made the headlines last week, what a colleague called me about from Greenland 2 days ago, saying that after 37 years of going to Greenland and studying the glaciers, he has never seen what he saw last week. The glaciers are bigger, the icebergs are bigger, more frequent, bigger on a scale of 3 times bigger than anything he's ever seen. There appears to be a new level of melting happening in Greenland this year. It's a warmer year. Last year was the warmest year on record in 180 years of meteorology. In Greenland, so we have water that's kind of just finding its lowest point and gathering into streams. You may have seen pictures like this in National Geographic. I took this one back in 2007. And the water finds a crack and gets down below the ice. And what happens is the glacier starts floating on the ice, so it doubles or triples its speed, breaking off into icebergs, which that's what raises sea level. Antarctica is the big problem, though. Antarctica is growing on the east, but the areas on the west side of Antarctica are destabilizing. And that is the potential sea level crisis. It has 7 times the amount of sea level locked up as Greenland, 186 feet theoretically if you melt it at all. Can happen for centuries, but we need to start being realistic about what can happen. And if you look at Antarctica without getting it all technical, this is a colorized map to show you what's happening in Antarctica, just to show you that there's real specificity to this, that the area in red at the 8 o'clock position there, that's the Pine Island glaciers. And there's 6 glaciers right there that we know, they're well mapped, and looking at a cross-section, they're being undercut now tens of miles inland, as shown here. So even what you see on the surface isn't really indicative of the problem. But those 7 glaciers, 6 or 7 glaciers in Antarctica hold at least 10 feet of sea level rise. We don't know whether that's going to slide into the ocean this century or next. That's just a flat truth. And we will not know. It's not a matter of measurements or modeling. That'd be like trying to measure an earthquake or when Yellowstone's going to erupt or when an avalanche is going to roll down a mountain or a landslide. We can study it all we want. We can't get the timing exact. All we know is the conditions are right. And the problem is in this case, and this is the absolute truth, and I've been there, and I've talked to scientists all the time who are there now, that the signs from Antarctica and Greenland are not good. We know a lot of what's happened historically because of ice cores shown here. We drill down, we can get 140,000 years of records in Greenland and 800,000 years of records in Antarctica. The bubbles in the person's fingers there shown is about a year of ice, which came from snow that was deposited. And the air molecules, which were in between the snow crystals, have now been trapped and are bubbles of pressurized air. They're air samples that go back 800,000 years. And different teams of scientists have decoded that and said, what was the carbon dioxide percentage at the time? We can tell the relative temperature because there's 2 molecules of oxygen, 16 and 18, like kind of like radiocarbon dating. By just looking at the difference in the ratio and because of molecular weight, again, simple physics, we know the relative temperature going back 800,000 years now. That's a new technology. We didn't have that when I studied this stuff 45 years ago. But we now have decoded, just like medicine has decoded things we didn't know about before. We have now decoded 800,000 years of climate, and we have a pretty good big picture. And this is the picture. I've taken the blue line I showed you a minute ago of sea level changing over 400,000 years, which is in the rock record. We can find ancient shorelines. We know temperature and carbon dioxide, as I've just shown you. And that 400,000 year, and this is one of the slides that you can get. Again, I'll remind you of that address when I'm done. But you can have this slide. It's probably the best single graphic to put in perspective climate change. It shows 4 ice age cycles, if you follow the red line, up and down, a normal bound of 9 degrees Fahrenheit, 5 degrees Celsius. Carbon dioxide normally goes between 180 and 280 parts per million. As shown in the upper right, in that little vertical line, it's now at 400 parts per million, as many of you know. That's what we're trying to reduce with better energy policies. And then at sea level goes up and down. And the 3 lines, you'll notice that the 3 graphs all have peaks that line up together. There's 4 ice age cycles there. The cycle is roughly between, well, it's between 95 and 125,000 years. So for approximation's sake, to take away a simple story, we've had ice ages about every 100,000 years. The last one peaked 20,000 years ago. And one of the reasons we were confused, and there was evidence 30 or 40 years, maybe the glaciers were growing, was kind of the tail end of the what would have been the start of the next cooling cycle 80,000 years from now to the next ice age. But we've warmed things. And we know why, because these graphs all go together. And you can see how the parallel character for 400,000 years. And the truth is, this graph could be extended 10 times to the left. It's been going on for 4 million years with hardly a change. But we're now in a new era. And while we do all these sustainability things and recycling and environmental and take care of the animals and all those things, we need to face up to a new reality. And it requires a new kind of planning. And it's sea level rise. It's different than the other sustainability things we're working on. As I work with different communities, trying to help them visualize, the question always is, how high do we have to plan for? Whether it be Norfolk or San Francisco or Annapolis, the question is, how high will it get? And as I've already explained to you, we can't possibly know that. And that's really a wicked problem. Truth, it truly is. But it's like, you know, take it to your personal lives. It's like, how long are we going to live? You know, or how long will all sorts of other uncertainties in life. We have those. That's what life is. And it may be disturbing, but, you know, I like to just say we need to deal with the hand we've been dealt, in effect. And what I come away with is we need to plan differently. We need to plan not for the end of the century, which most people talk about, the year 2100, 84 years from now. That's far too long in the future. But for most people, long-term planning is 5 or 10 years, right? In fact, it's hard to get companies to plan 5 years now. But even cities and even the Defense Department often plans 10 years out for long-term planning. I say, you can't see sea level rise in 10 years. You have to look at least 30 years out to see potential problems. And I have come to believe that that's a prime planning horizon, 30 years. And I really recommend that to you. And I hope you, and maybe we'll have some later discussion about this as if I get involved with you, because we need to get people to think about 30 years out so we can do better 10-year planning. Does that make sense? That back to that Stephen Covey maxim, begin with the end in mind. And I want to show you some examples of where that's worked and not worked. Because the fact is that we know enough from the current levels and the trajectories that sea level is going to rise, temperature is going to rise, and even if we work to reduce carbon dioxide, it's not going to come down back to 350, as some would like it to be, in the next few decades. So when we look at these charts and projections about sea level rise, I want you to think about a couple of things. That planning for the midline is, frankly, silly or stupid, depending on how you want to, how insulting you want to be. I think I said stupid at the Naval Academy, and I regretted it. But they still took it well. They realized the silliness of it, let's put it nicely. And the fact is, the upper line here is not the upper line. So how do you plan for that really wicked problem? Well, we've got to find the right perspective, and we've got to find the right terminology. We have to characterize sea level rise different from the other resiliency, sustainability issues. It touches on them. As sea level rises, it will make them worse. Here's an example from the Netherlands. It's a town I visited 2 years ago, Vlissingen, down near the Belgian border, I guess, and I think some of you are here from the Netherlands. But this shows how the Dutch, with their cleverness and their having to learn for 1,000 years how to cope with land succumbing to the sea. And here's showing levees. The road is higher than the levee. The building height's higher than the road height. And the ground floor, by regulation in this town, has a wash through, that there's, even if a wave went through the ground floor, the bottom 15 feet, there's no damage to the electrical components. So it's a great example of how you can design for higher sea level and storm surge and extreme tides. But this won't work in Miami or Florida or the Maldives or the Bahamas where I used to live or any coral-based or limestone-based island or land structure, because the porosity of the limestone means that this won't work. This only works where you have enough clay in the soils so that the levee keeps the water out. Many of you have flown through Schiphol Airport, Amsterdam Airport. It's 11 feet below sea level. They've been doing that for 1,000 years with windmills and earthen levees, as like we do in New Orleans. But that's not going to get us to deal with sea level rise. Not for the long term. An example of the kind of inventiveness we're going to have to come up with is shown here by these famous gates at Rotterdam Harbor, the Maaslant Kering. You've probably seen pictures of them. When I visited them, and they're most impressive, each structure is the size of the Eiffel Tower. It's huge. It was designed for a 1 in 10,000 year storm for the worst river flooding to come down the three rivers from Europe. And it was designed back in the 80s. And 30 centimeters or 1 foot of sea level rise. Because that's all they could imagine. And the Dutch are good engineers. So the good news is we can be creative and come up with structures that will protect some places. But here's the bad news. It was a foot of sea level rise. They now know that this almost billion-dollar structure isn't going to be adequate sometime mid-century. They're now, let me tell you the story of how they've changed. Again, they have a 1,000-year history of dealing with water and coastal defenses. And this was going to be the crowning piece. After the storm in 1953, when 1,835 people died one night, they said never again, and they set about to engineer. And this was the last piece of the Delta Works program. But they designed it for up to a foot of sea level rise. And now the engineers have said to me, John, if we knew then what we know now, we would have built this 2 meters or 7 feet higher. In fact, beyond that, the Queen held a council meeting with all of her ministers in 2007 and 2008, a series of meetings. Queen Beatrix at the time, and one of my group members was in the meeting as an expert, and she went around and said, I understand that sea level is going to be higher. What do we plan for? And after lots of explanations, it became obvious they didn't know what the number would be this century for the reasons I've explained to you. They're good engineers. So finally she said, she didn't talk about the wicked problem, but finally she said, okay, we have to do the right thing and be responsible. And in the face of uncertainty, let's plan higher. And in the lack of an objective number, how many centimeters it'll be, we're going to plan for 3 meters. That's 10 feet of sea level rise this century. And the Netherlands is now spending $1 billion a year for that little country to plan for higher sea level, beyond what they had done when this was finished. That's quite a statement. We need to do some things similar to that. Now, it's going to take us a couple of decades to adapt our culture and understanding. But the reason I'm so excited to be here with you today and give you this depressing news is that if you think about it, when you go home and process this and digest this, you're going to realize that there's some wisdom in here and that this can be a clarion call for better planning, and that most of you in this room will have an opportunity to share this perception. And I've even thought about how that might go, because people aren't going to want to hear the big bad story all at once. But in different meetings, when there are structures and zoning issues and so on being brought up for how do we cope with being resilient to flooding, I would like to recommend to you that you just say simply, well, how much sea level rise do we want to plan for? And I'm sure people on the other side of the table, the mayor, governor, whoever, you know, different department heads or companies building something, big commercial buildings, will say, well, what do the experts say? You say, well, there was that article in the New York Times on March 30th and Washington Post that said from Antarctica, we should plan for another 3 feet of sea level rise, up as much as 6 feet. And we heard an expert at our meeting in Phoenix that said it could be higher than that yet. So here's this, how I super simplify this. We need to start planning for the first 3 feet of sea level rise as soon as possible. Now, it's overly simplistic, but I've actually gotten traction on this in both Annapolis and the Bay Area. Begin planning for the first 3 feet of sea level rise as soon as possible. It's elegant, actually. It doesn't pretend that we know the number of inches, we know the year. And by saying the first 3 feet, we're conveying a lot of information, because we can't stop it at 3 feet. We may delay it if we do all the right sustainability things. Now, some places, because of subsidence of the land, you may need to adapt that. And we need to look at that individually in terms of a vulnerability assessment, and then helping people to think through what does a 30-year plan mean We're doing that in Annapolis now. There's other places that are starting to look at this 30-year idea. It's a sweet spot. It's a mortgage cycle. It's within a lifetime. No, it's, think about it. You know, 5 or 10 years doesn't get you to see the problem. But if you think about 30 years, you can see a new era and some possibilities. And that's within reach. And so that's what I would like to kind of leave you with. I think the important thing is that there's no greater professional group in the world probably than sitting right in front of me. Now, I may realize it's the last part of the last day, and it's been a busy 4 days, and you're not in full force here. But I would hope that the American Planning Association will see this not as an end to this conference, but really as the beginning of a new way to look at a bigger problem. I like to close with a photo from a couple of years ago of my daughter at the beach and with a friend. And, you know, we have to think of the future. We also have to think of how to pass this on to future generations. Certainly there's risk, but there's risk in a lot of things. There's risk every time we get in a car or an airplane, every time we do lead our lives. But there's opportunities. There's a huge opportunity to plan and adapt over the coming decades. And again, you can guide the conversation. You don't have to get people to go through the 9 steps or get to the ultimate goal, but you can lay the groundwork that we need to think bigger. We can play, if we think ahead what can happen in 30 years, we can begin planning better for 10 years so that we don't repeat the misstep of the Dutch with the Maslin carrying those big $800 million gates. We plan high enough because it's a better investment. We'll get a better return on investment. So here's the email I gave you earlier. It's just apa@johnenglander.net. If you send me that, you will get a short slide set of the graphics. There's other ways to follow me and so on. And I truly would welcome hearing from you. There's various ways to find me all over the place. But you each will have applications, whether it be cities or companies or projects. And if I can help you, I'd love to do that. I think this is a great opportunity. And thank you for your attention at the end of 4 busy days. And I'll take some questions. Thank you. There's two microphones. There's two microphones up here. If anybody does want a question, just come up. And I even brought a copy of my book as a prize for the best question of the day. Yes.
Hi, my name is Emily. I'm a PhD student at Texas A&M. And I also went to the Dutch Dialogues speak this morning. And I think the last thing that I had wrote is that, how do you break down the scale for the average person? Because I felt like that is an issue. My focus is community education. And then one of the first things you said is think bigger, think further. And so I guess, how do you find that balance between thinking far ahead as a planner, but also making it relatable to the average community member who doesn't really necessarily see the financial investment as being applicable during their lifetime?
This is the hardest change we're ever going to face. The shoreline's going to move, okay? It has just started to do so. And you've got to find the right words for the right audience. When I briefed all of the admirals in the Coast Guard, and I heard that some of them didn't even believe in climate change, but once I persuaded them some of the basic facts, I said, you know, if you're guarding the coast, you better know where the coast is going to be in the future. And you have 200 bases that are vulnerable to sea level rise. And I got their attention, and we started talking about how could they plan 30 years out, and it interested them at that point. There is nothing that I can say or any of you can do next week that is going to allow the world to take this in and embrace it and adapt to it. We need to recognize that whether it be that smoking causes cancer, that AIDS is a problem, that paying attention, the foods we eat, exercise, whatever those things are, these are generational lessons. This is a really tough one. This is a super wicked problem. Most of you didn't realize probably how much it is or how much it's unstoppable or how much we can't define the number. So I've added to your burden a little bit. But all I would say is think of this as a marathon, that we need to change this decade by decade. Adapting to a higher coastline or to a higher sea level and a moving coastline is going to be a huge challenge. But here's another good news part of this. This isn't going to kill many people. I don't mean that facetiously. I mean, this isn't like a tsunami that kills 200,000 people one night, or a storm or the flu, which can kill millions of people. Most people can get out of the way of sea level rise at a couple of inches a year. it's going to be very disruptive. It's very emotional. What about the Florida Keys where I like to go fishing or diving or something like that, or my grandmother's house? All of those things are real problems, okay? But compared to the things we normally think of as catastrophes, which is hundreds of thousands of people dying, this won't do that. Now, it's going to be disruptive in terms of human health issues, communities, economies. But it means we need to look at these things differently because, as we saw this morning in that talk, just looking at New Orleans and Norfolk, where the land's subsiding, gives you kind of a jaundiced picture. You say, well, they have a problem, and thinking it's not the other thousand cities on the coast. That's partly the message here, is this is a universal problem for all coastal low-lying areas. And so we have to educate ourselves. This is a paradigm shift, not much different as I actually opened my book saying that Galileo, you know, with the sun being the center of the solar system, was a disruptive idea. There's lots of disruptive ideas. They take a while to process. We have this instant, you know, mentality today that, well, we'll just get the facts and go on from there. That's not going to happen that quickly. Yes.
Oh, can I just say really quick that the Wicked Problems reading, that was the very first reading for all of the MEP students that they do every year, so it's like the core of our program.
Oh, thank you.
It's our favorite reading.
I didn't know that, but thank you. Okay. Yes.
So my question was in regards to, you're talking about sea level rise, and I appreciate that that's small, and then there are those of us in the room who live in the Southwest or in the middle of the country and say, great, that's somebody else's problem. My bigger concern is that as sea level rises, as the glaciers, the polar caps melt, if I have the terminology right, and I agree the science isn't so good,
that's
if
right.
The Atlantic conductor shuts down, you're getting stronger El Niños, you're getting worse droughts in California, you're getting higher temperatures. I saw up to 8 inches higher or 8 degrees higher in the Southwest, which if you see that, impacts all of us in food growing regions. So how does that interconnect? And is that something that you're addressing?
The disruptions that are going to be caused by changing temperature, changing ocean currents, sea level rise are going to be huge. Let's not, I want to make sure we're clear on that. I'm not in any way trivializing or making fun of that. It's going to be beyond what I can imagine. What I want you to do is join me in my role where I've taken the voice of kind of like a good doctor and say, okay, I've got terrible news for you, but now what are your options? We need people who can guide us that we trust, okay? And I think you as planners can help do that. But you're absolutely right. The idea that sea level will be 3 feet higher and then more is going to be disruptive to agriculture. And even if you're not in the ocean, the first guy that bought a dozen of my books when it came out 3.5 years was an attorney from Iowa. And I called him up. I said, why are you ordering 12 books from Iowa about sea level rise? He said, well, John, he says, first of all, you know, people in Iowa do travel in the wintertime. We go to Florida to the Keys and stuff like that. But he said, beyond that, he said, farmers are very conscious of weather. And they actually pay attention to the El Nino years out in the Pacific because it changes the amount of rainfall they get. They're not stupid. And in fact, the idea that sea level could disrupt ports and the fact that sea level is going to raise the base and on top of that storms and extreme tides, there are some pretty savvy people here. And they know that the global supply chain for shipping grains may change. So this is a very interconnected world. What I'm trying to pull out for you is where we tend to think of sea level like a storm surge or like an extreme tide, or being part of the reducing greenhouse gases, you know, as if that's going to solve it, okay? That's how I'm trying to kind of define it for you. But you're absolutely right. It's a very complex problem with complex implications.
Thank you.
One more question?
Hi. Thank you so much. My name is George, and I'm a master's student at the University of British Columbia. I want to not only thank you for your wonderful talk that was really accessible here, but also for the APA for raising this issue. I think this is it speaks to the organization that we're talking about.
I want to congratulate the APA
in a really powerful
too.
Way. My question is specifically about, I think, related to these this idea of the spillover effects of sea level rise. I've done a little bit of work in sea level rise, and we talk about, you know, different strategies for dealing with this, so protection, adaptation, and retreat. And I think a lot of the images you showed here, and I'm not sure if this was deliberate or not, but gave the impression that maybe the most important thing we can be doing is protecting areas that are going to be, you know, inundated with sea level rise. When I think about, you mentioned Bangladesh, which is a place that I've lived and worked in, a lot of those areas aren't going to be able to protect. There is just no way for them to armor themselves against the water that's coming in. So I wonder if you can just shed a little light for us on the idea that unfortunately, we're going to have to leave a lot of places behind and maybe pull back from those areas rather than, you know, doing as the Dutch have done in diking and things like that. Thank you.
Great question, great point, and you're absolutely right. If you want to fast forward in your minds, you know, three or four generations, your great-great-grandkids, whatever, sea level is going to be 5 or 10 feet higher for sure, maybe more. Hardening the shoreline is not going to be relevant. But we have some generations, some 30-year time periods, some mortgage cycles, some building cycles in between to figure out how do we make that transition. But the idea that we're still confusing about hardening a shoreline against wave damage from a storm, which is valid, doesn't hold up against sea level rise. And in places that are flat and porous limestone, like Miami, where they're putting in $400 million of pumps to keep salt water off the streets every 28 days right now, because that's what's happening, it's going to challenge us. We're going to have to think differently. And the truth is, I don't have all the answers. One of the reasons I'm excited to not only meet you, but perhaps to join you and work with you, is this is the biggest planning challenge we ever faced. It's not going to be easy. Seawalls are not going to do it. But at some point, the low-lying areas, we've only got three choices, I guess, technically. One is to retreat, two is to elevate, or three is to put it in an underwater bubble of some sort, right? Or visit it with scuba gear. I mean, when the ocean is higher, the ocean doesn't care what we think. It doesn't care what we want. It doesn't care what laws we pass. You know, we fool ourselves sometimes thinking that Congress can be the decider, okay? The ocean's gonna rise. I had two mayors, one in California, one in Florida, say to me, well, Mr. Englander, I get what you're saying, but who's gonna pay for us to adapt? In both cases, I said something to the effect of, I said, Mr. Mayor, I don't know who's going to pay, but I know that you're going to adapt or you won't have any voters anymore when the water's around their ankles. I mean, this is a different kind of problem. This is not a choice. The choice here, and you've reminded me, I probably left out this intended sentence. The choice here is whether we plan for this or let it happen like most things where we deal with crisis later. But what's different here is this gets into all of our infrastructure. Bridges and tunnels need to be designed accordingly. When I was in Annapolis, some people said, well, we'll wait 20 years and see if we need to raise the bridges. I said, wait a minute. The bridge clearance now is a foot, you know, sailboat masts or freighters. We're not going to go around and raise all the bridges. Well, maybe we'll have to. But we have infrastructure that lasts 50 or 100 years all the time. It is stupid to think that we'll wait to see what happens with sea level rise before we need to adapt. You, within your audience, have people who are highly influential in major corporations or small consulting firms of experts or positions within cities. I can't do this alone, you can't do this alone, but I think together, with some new curriculum, some new methodology, some new ways of talking about the problem, we can affect how we plan for the future. So I guess that's where I'd like to leave it.
Thank you.
Thank you. You're welcome.
Thank you, John. Well, from our first sessions on Friday until this session right now, we have been challenged to think faster, smarter, bigger, and farther. No small feat. Thank you for joining me at the 108th National Planning Conference. I hope this has been as great a conference for you as it has been for me, and I look forward to seeing you in New York.